Land of the Yeti. Land of romance. Land of adventure. Land of mystery. Land of superstition. The legend of the Yeti, the abominable snowman, has teased and intrigued the world. Many weird stories have come down to us from the high Himalayas about a giant anthropoid with a human face, human cunning, and superhuman ferocity. Some ape-like being that prowls those mountains at heights of 18 to 20,000 feet. Many natives of Nepal, Bhutan, Sikkim, Tibet, northern India have claimed to have seen the Yeti. And finally, an expedition was organized to make a business of clearing up the mystery of the elusive Yeti. It was led by the most qualified man alive today, the conqueror of Mount Everest, Sir Edmund Hillary.
10 days out of Kathmandu, the landscape changes abruptly. We became surrounded by steep cliffs with swift streams and waterfalls. And by now, our whole party could appreciate the beauty of the scenery again, having grown accustomed to their blisters and the inconveniences. The Yeti country was in sight, and what a sight. Gauri Shankar, 23,700 feet, a great goddess amongst mountains. Dorje expressed it for all of us when he wrote, "It is an act of worship to just sit and look at high mountains, to feel lost in smallness." We relaxed on boulders warmed by the sun, and munched chocolate and swilled lemon juice spiky with ice crystals from our water bottles. After bedding, observation camps were to be set up on both sides of the valley. Each camp was to have two tents, two sarbs and four sherpas. Each was to be self-contained, to keep movement at a minimum, and they were going to be equipped with powerful viewing glasses. Here with me is Peter Mulgrew, Royal New Zealand Navy, who would man one of the higher camps. After 3 weeks of bedding, we moved our base camp for reconnaissance up to beautiful Milk Lake, Deep Pokery, as the Sherpas call it. At 15,700 feet on the Rapimu Glacier, next to the Menang Glacier, where Eric Shipton took his footprint photographs. This lake is considered sacred by Buddhists and Hindus alike. Tradition has it that the god Vishnu bathed in the lake of milk and rested where we pitched our tents. There was a rim of ice around the edge of the lake, but this didn't stop our Sherpas from having a frolic in there on their air mattresses. We sarbs stayed out. We much preferred the warmth of the ingeniously improvised sauna steam bath put up by Tom Nevison. It was built up of stones, heated to the vaporized water poured on them, and covered with clear plastic sheeting. We were like goldfish in a bowl, but it enabled us to rid ourselves of a month's layer of dirt and grime. A Sherpa returned from a 3,000 foot reconnaissance climb with the announcement of the discovery of Yeti footprints. In only minutes, the whole camp was alive with enthusiasm.
We've seen some Yeti footprints there, right up on the Rapimu, where you were camping. Did you find out everything about it?
Of course, the word of discovered tracks set everything and everyone in motion. We climbed from the 15,700 foot altitude to over 18,000 feet, where the footprints were located, was a very forced march, for many of our party anyway. This was the highest altitude some, except for airplane travel, had ever experienced. The forces of high altitude can be quite harsh. Dizziness, blurred vision, depression, and extreme fatigue can set in, making every step a great effort, and even breathing a reluctant chore. Here, such complaints soon passed, however, especially in the light of the encouraging news of Yeti evidence. Okay, chaps, let's get cracking. Well, they were all right. Anyone happening upon such a stretch of crack could, I suppose, be justified in claiming them to be the footprints of a giant biped, a mountain gorilla, or the abominably elusive snowman. In any event, the finding of the prints encouraged us all, and we redoubled our efforts to make the hunt a thorough, serious business. Where in the strange landscape Yeti lived, we just didn't know. Even the Sherpas didn't know, but they were absolutely sure that, along with the mountain gods, supernatural animals, and ice spirits, this frozen wilderness also housed the Yeti. We camped and looked. Our reconnaissance parties were diligent and far-ranging, but we found nothing but more prints, which the Sherpas swore were those of a snowman.
They do look like human footprints, the toes, the ankle, the heel a bit elongated. What do you make of it?
Well, Lyle, on the face of it, they look very much like the prints of a biped, suggesting those of a giant ape. And they were found only about 3 miles from the Shipton prints. But then an interesting transformation occurred, Lyle.
What do you mean by transformation?
Well, when we traced the prints out of the bright sunlight into a shaded area, they plainly became the tracks of a small quadruped. A cluster of small pug marks were expanded by the sun into large 15-inch feet, with other pugs forming toes and heels. I'm afraid Sherpa imagination has accepted these tracks as natural to their religious and mystical world of gods and demons.
That doesn't prevent the Yeti from making tracks, however, does it?
No, that's absolutely right, Lowell. And short of actually seeing or capturing a Yeti, our hunt had gone well. We devoted 2 months to the search and exhausted every possible lead. We collected a good supply of Yeti stories. We'd acquired some furs, which some of the Yeti legend can be put down to. This is the fur of the Tibetan blue bear.
A beauty, my, it's unusual. Well, since it's pretty hard to prove that something does not exist, I guess that's about as close to positive proof as you're likely to get, isn't it?
I think so, Lowell. I did make a kind of discovery of my own on this expedition, though. During this Yeti search, I became particularly aware of the hold that superstition and mysticism have on the Sherpa people. Here is a simple, unsophisticated, cheerful, generous, and worthy race. I'm very fond of them. And they urgently need the tools of education. They know of this need, and they have an intense desire for their children to have the opportunity to learn. But they have no schools. Only about 1 man in 10 there can read or write, and none of the women can do either. Yet they're conscious that a knowledge of reading and writing could make them more receptive to improvements in their agriculture, their homes, and in their health. Also, they've heard that the Chinese are building schools in Tibet, not too far away across the border. I promised them I'd try to help them. On our trip back to the States with the scout, I proposed the school-building idea to our sponsor, the World Book Encyclopedia, and they generously agreed to back it. Our first step was to find a suitable teacher. This we did. Kunjung was the first school in this area and inspired us to carry on with the school building program. We have worked wholeheartedly and unselfishly on these schools because it is for the benefit of the people we love, tough people who have proven their loyalty and generosity countless times and who have shown many times how quickly superficial differences among men disappear under trying circumstances. I personally feel an obligation to do something in return for their help to me. Not only have I learned to respect their strength, loyalty, and humor, but I have come to regard them as brothers and very good friends.